analysis because there might be affect our contracted area belong to protected area. That's why first thing what be the protected area taking contracted area or not. If not clarified, I don't think all contractors provide the every data they have. That's one of things I concern. Even I like to give, but it's not my authority to provide the all data to, because our government invests 15 years money to environmental study. And as you guys mentioned, all data contractor has the most, but which contractor provide data for, they losing their contract area for protected. That's one thing I continuously in my mind. Please first clarify that thing is first.
David?
Thank you very much. Firstly, just to say that I agree with Craig that there should be goals spelt out in the environmental management plan, and that I've missed that out of my framework, so that's not very helpful. And I also further agree with what Michael had to say, in that the environmental management plan can quite clearly articulate these different compartments of the whole. And so if having listened carefully to the comments during the discussion today, I think there is an easy way in the environmental management plan of pulling this all together. So a strategic objective for the contractor areas, for example, is that the contractors use their best efforts and best environmental practice within the areas that they have for their operation. At the same time, they would wish to develop guidelines for the impact reference zones and the preservation reference zones within those areas as well, in agreement with the authority. And it's quite clear as well that the idea of harmonizing environmental data gathered during the exploration phase could be a high-level strategic objective for those areas. And I also think Sam's point of looking at rehabilitation strategies is a relevant high-level strategic objective for those areas. But then separately for the AEI areas, I think I support what Petra has said, that this is a nested approach. So we're looking for, to further refine the proposal for the nine areas, establish conservation objectives for those areas, define what the baseline is, and look at biological monitoring over and above. And I think all of those, the comments that you've received, can be slotted into this environmental management plan, provided it's structured in the right way.
So that will give you my
two of them on in your nostrils.
You want me to say that, Flower?
Yeah, she's got to write the wording now. She's got to pick it.
I would like to present something on the screen. Maybe it's better than...
We'll have to do that after the break, unfortunately. Okay. We have some technical issues. You might have seen it going up and down a little bit. It didn't come all the way down, so.
Can I make a comment? I think that clearly, there are multiple interests, and we need to balance the multiple interests. And I think, personally, I think a clear goal of the of protection of biodiversity and setting up of areas of environmental interest is to avoid conflict wherever possible with the current claim areas, and absolutely not put any more burdens on the contractors. The contractors are grandfathered into this whole system, and I think that that's an obligation of the seabed authority to manage this area, I think, in a way that doesn't infringe on the existing rights and contracts of the contractors. So I think, and I also, to be honest, I'm kind of baffled by this. I think it's in the contractor's best interest to be able to tell the world that the seabed authority is protecting biodiversity in the framework of their exploitation activities. I actually think that the biggest impediment to mining on the long run is if the world, if much of the, if in environmental organizations, global populations decides that this isn't being environmentally managed well, then there will be a lot of outcry about mining at all. So I think that early on, taking accepted, internationally accepted procedures to protect biodiversity in a balanced way as the mining claims are developed is essential for this to really go forward. That's my maybe naive view. But I think it's really incumbent on everybody not to put more burdens on the contractors, because they have a legal and justifiable framework for their what they've claimed for their claims. Thank you.
Behind you.
I try to avoid to not say much, but what Greg says, I totally agree, because we already been environmental survey for 15 years. It's for purpose of the developing the manganese nozzle. However, we provide the data for the making the protection area, but which means we already contribute for the conservate the biodiversity, something else. Not only for maybe here, someone say, even I'm scientist, but now I know like the contractor developer. But if any NGO for conservation of biodiversity, they thought contractor is just developmental. No, that looks like we follow the old rules to the check the environmental impact and also try to find how minimize and also protect our contract area. But seems like here is we are all one side of person to do the just the development. I don't think so, because environmental survey data is make much better finding the which area is best place to the making the protection area. That's I take it as that means what Craig said, and so I totally agree with that.
Yeah, I also fully agree with what Craig says. In nowadays world, it's not possible to do big industrial activities without taking care of the environment, of course. And so I think it's very necessary that we, at an early stage, set out these nine environmental protection areas, and for the contractors and possible future mining companies that invest money, it must be clear at a very early stage where these areas are, and that there is no conflict with the contractors' areas. So I also agree with what you said. Our data should not be used that we supply to the International Seabed Authority to provide any potential conflict with the contractors' areas, of course.
Pedro?
I think we need to understand this as two different categories of protection. On the one side, we have the big areas where the Seabed Authority defined in order to accomplish international law of protecting the environment, and we leave them as they are. Let's say no take areas, no. We try to leave them pristine, whatever you want to mention that. On the other side, and these big areas that are outside the claims, and the contractors have no obligation in that. This is just an obligation of the seabed authority to develop a plan on how to put both interests in concordance, protection of nature and extraction of nodules. On the other side, we have within the claims, actually we believe that no area will be pristine after the extraction will start, but the contractors have the obligation to try to minimize the impact and try to develop some strategies of mitigation and things like that. And this includes that the contractors will define some of the areas within the claim that may be affected by the plume, may be affected by other activities, but you will need to try to minimize the impact by this environmental plan within your claim. So these are two different levels of protection. The big one is complete protection, let's say, or complete trying to leave things as they are, and the other one is trying to minimize impact.
Dave Billett?
Yes, just to reiterate that, and I think that follows on from what the CBD were looking at. One is a strategic environmental assessment and plan, and the other is for an environmental impact plan, which is more specific to the activity within an area, within a small area.
Malcolm?
Following on from that, while we're on the subject, I think we need to be a little bit careful about the objectives stated with the nine areas versus the impact reference zones inside a contracted area, because the nine areas proposal isn't based solely on scientists taking a clean sheet of the CCZ. It factors in avoiding some of the, or it does factor in avoiding the licensed areas. So the two aren't independent. It's not as if the big strategic nine area one was not already sort of compromised, if you like. So there are two slightly different and possibly conflicting issues here with the nested approach. It's not a scientific nested approach. There's a bit of politics already built in. So I think we just need to keep that in mind in terms of how the two issues are treated, especially as it comes down to potentially altering regulations.
Thank you. Craig?
Another way to say what Malcolm just said is that the interest of protecting biodiversity has already made major concessions to the mining interests. The mining claims have been the only game in town, and protection, the interest of protecting biodiversity has to play catch-up. Is that sort of what you're saying, Malcolm? And in principle, there should be a balance, and I think you need to balance all the interests, potential interests in the CCC.
Christina.
Thank you. I would just like to reiterate what Pedro and Dave and Malcolm said, and Craig, in terms of trying to balance the conservation, biodiversity, and sustainable use objectives. And what I'm hearing here seems to make lots of sense in terms of using the nine areas as a large commitment to maintaining some intact areas. But then you still need to look at what's going on within the contractors' areas, but that may be a longer-term aspect when you're developing the regulations for exploitation of mineral resources. I think our focus here could be on some broader, higher level principles, and we don't need to go down into what is actually going to happen in the exploitation phase for these specific areas, given that you already have fairly explicit requirements under the Law of the Sea Convention and the regulations about areas, the impact reference areas and impact preservation, whatever the two areas are called. But that those may still need to be retained, given what you're finding within the contractor's areas, but that that would be subject to later scientific research and what is going on. And I would just like to reiterate the question of transparency of the data that has been collected so far. My understanding is there is an obligation to share the data that is relevant to the environment with the seabed authority. And hopefully that can be a large part of what we're doing here, is to make sure that that information flow continues and is accelerated, because that is a sort of information that would broadly inform all of seabed mining as well as biodiversity protection.
Thank you. Any more comments? Please.
Sorry, if I can just elaborate. What Dave was saying on the strategic environmental assessment, I think that's one aspect that absolutely needs to be part of this environmental plan, is that the contractors have an interest in looking at the impacts specifically within their zone. But what I haven't seen so far is an overall vision or even idea of what the cumulative impacts of these activities will be. I mean, maybe that is implicit in some of the work that Craig has been doing, and it's the justification for it. But I think it would also help in the longer term to be able to portray that image and impact, and to combine that then with other activities that are going on, and also even factoring in climate change. And I'm not sure ocean acidification, if that's an issue that far deep, but there are other impacts affecting the marine environment there that would be very useful to think about.
Thank you.
Thank you. I just wonder what's the meaning of the core areas of those nine areas, and if it's meaning that it will be closed for exploration or exploitation, then I think that it will run counter to what the convention has stipulated. Because the convention has clearly said that the council could only close areas for exploitation only when there are substantial evidence indicates the risk of serious harms to the marine environment. So we have to look at these articles of the convention. That's the framework that we design in a new environment plan. Actually, from the first 2 days, it's very clear that the contractor has done a lot of work, environment work, very excellent work. So when we try to do more, we have to stand on what the convention has provided. Thank you.
Pedro.
But okay, you are the lawyer. I'm not a lawyer, but I think this is a very own interpretation of the law, because there are also things like the precautionary approach and other things that actually could give another view of the law. So substantial risk is evident if you are going to remove the habitat. So starting by this, it is clear that there will be an impact. So how are you going to prove that mining will not alter the habitat and will be no risk to the biodiversity there?
Yes, please.
May I add some comments with respect to my point of view? What's the meaning of precautious approach? This word is very popular these days, but these terms cannot be used to justify any measures that only because you are worried. You have to have scientific basis. And let's take one example. That is the 1995 UN Fish Stock Agreement. In that agreement, that's an agreement the first time introduced this precautionary approach. But when applied this approach, there is a very important elements, that is the reference point. You have to have some objective reference point you can apply this precautionary approach. That's my understanding. Thank you.
Pedro?
Precautionary approach says that lack of knowledge should not prevent you in protecting nature. And your interpretation of the law, I mean, I have here the paragraph. It says, the regulation says that prospecting shall not be undertaken if substantial evidence indicates the risk of serious harm to marine environment. It is not like you have said that only if there is no risk, then, you know?
Christina.
On the precautionary approach, the Fish Stocks Agreement is a very important articulation of the precautionary approach, but it is also embodied in numerous other instruments, such as the Rio Declaration Plus 15 that's referred to here, plus the London Protocol, plus that's the Convention on Biological Diversity. So there's numerous places, and I think in terms of cost effectiveness, that is in the Rio Declaration, which is not embodied in all the other ones, but I think that's already implicit in our discussions here. I would just point out, based on what Pedro is saying, in terms of if you did have an explicit reading of Article 33, that's in terms of the risk of serious harm to the marine environment. If you take Pedro literally, then you would already know that there is a serious risk of harm to the marine environment from the removal of the substrate, and in which case there is justification for taking immediate measures now before the serious harm occurs to ameliorate, minimize that risk throughout the wider marine environment. And I think that's sort of fundamentally your purpose for creating this environmental management plan, given the known destructive nature of the mining, of the removing of the substrate.
Thank you. Well, why don't we take this opportunity, one more.
Maybe I have only a question to Greg. Why? Why this nine area are situated only between Clarionic-Clipperton zone? Because on the seafloor they are not boundary, because Clarion and Clipperton fracture zone extend maybe for 100 kilometers. Because during the mining plumes, resedimentation go down on the north, on the south. It's why they are limited only between this zone, and management of environment plan is only focus between Clarionic-Clipperton zone. Maybe it should be a little bit outside position.
Well, there are two answers to that question. One is that based on the best available data, we do think that there are subregions that potentially have a unique fauna within the Clipperton Clarion zone. So we need to be aware that the areas outside, we have ecological by geographic reasons to think that those are different. So we need to protect areas within the zone. And also another reason is that this is the management area is bounded by the areas of mining interests at this point. And as activities, exploitation activities on the seabed expand to broader areas, then the management and environmental protection measures, the balance between mining or whatever activities that go on and environmental protection, need to broaden out and go into broader zones. For example, on the mid-ocean ridges, if massive sulfides claims are filed, obviously you need to expand the areas of management. But you start with the areas that are potentially impacted and potentially unique within particular target area of exploitation activities to begin with. Does that answer your question?
Example for resedimentation of this fine fraction, which will be during mining. This plume suspension, it may go out hundreds of kilometers outside the areas because of currents, because of many other. Why? Because resedimentation will be not only in this area, on the seafloor, they are not boundary between currents, between fauna, between its transition zone should be, I think.
Well, if the mining activity is restricted to the CCZ until other activities occur beyond, in essence, everywhere beyond the CCZ is already in an unimpacted area. So there isn't a need to define protected areas beyond the CCZ because there is no planned activity. Now, what the network that we've designed is for benthic impacts, not for water column impacts. And based on plume modeling and transport times and the nature of physical transport in the abyss, there is reason to believe, the best available evidence suggests that by the time you get 100 kilometers away from the mining activity, there will be enough dilution and settlement out from the plume that the sedimentation from the plume on the seafloor will be well below the rates of natural sediment accumulation. So that's the rationale for a 100-mile buffer zone and not a larger one, that by the time you're 100 miles away, the benthic effects are likely to be minimal or not insignificant. That's not necessarily true for the water column, where particle loading the water column isn't used to be dealing with sediment accumulation. So there may be effects in the water column that are farther afield than 100 kilometers, but that's another set of impacts and set of environmental considerations that need to be addressed that are not addressed here, in part because the seabed authority has competence at the seabed. It doesn't have competence in the water column. Legal, it doesn't have a legal mandate to manage the water column.
Sam?
Yeah, I put my hand up before Craig spoke, and I was going to say the same thing, that essentially if there is no mining or mineral interest outside the CCZ, then by default it becomes an area that acts like a protected area, I suppose, because it's not touched. But that doesn't mean that during monitoring, that monitoring stations, well, I don't think anyway, that it doesn't mean that monitoring stations has to necessarily be within those nine zones. That can go, I would have thought, beyond, whether it's in the water column or extended seafloor.
Dave Billet?
Yes, it might be useful to actually go and look at the posters outside, because the actual plan itself already has a sort of buffer ring around where the main activity for mining will occur. And should then be new claims that then start to fall outside that area, then obviously there would have to be a review during the time when we review the plan that we have, to accommodate that and to plan for any expansion that goes outside this area or to a new area. But at the moment, the environmental action plan, if you like, of including the nine area plan, actually allows for a buffer around where the main activity will occur.
Question to Professor Smith. Maybe it is not a good question. No, because I am not a biologist. How this fauna, it does not move because over a period of years it may be moving in different places. What we are talking about 100 kilometer, it does not go out of this area anytime. It will remain there for years.
Different components of the fauna have different rates of mobility. And some components, the sediment fauna doesn't move very much on generation times. It may move meters. Other components of the fauna, the fish will move. But there is a major component of the fauna that is sessile. For example, the sponges that live on nodules, they attach and they remain in one place throughout their lifetime. And there are components of the fauna, for example, the nematode worms, that have no large dispersal stage. They don't have a larva that can disperse. They live in the sediments. They produce young that remain in the sediments, and their mobility is probably scales of meters, in maybe tens of meters in a lifetime, which could be years or even decades. So some of the fauna is mobile, some of it isn't, and that's part of the challenge of protection, that you have to have protected areas that integrate a large enough area that they protect some scales of mobility, and then they have to be networked or close enough together that they protect other scales of mobility.
Reason I put the question, in the shallow water, we have seen if we dig some place, more fishes comes there. And if we put the light there, much more fishes comes there. When the activity will start, a lot of the lighting activity will be there. It may attract to the area where we are working also. That's why I put that question.
Yeah, well, some of the fauna is mobile, and some of them are scavengers and predators, and they would be attracted to an activity that alters the environment. But there are other components of the fauna that are not mobile and require very stable conditions in over a small area, and will remain. Their range is very small. So there is a whole range of different kinds of mobility patterns and life histories. And part of conserving biodiversity or protecting biodiversity in a balance with exploitation is that there is a whole range of different kinds of life histories or natural histories that need to be protected.
Yes, Jin?
Thank you. I just want to maybe make some clarification that so far we talk about the areas, both for preserved riverland area or area of environmental interest. I think we're based on the current instrument and the regulation which we adopted. I just want to say that we talk about the preserved riverland area. I think in accordance with the regulations, relevant regulation. And then I believe the contractor have some responsibility and obligation. But this not necessarily means when we talk about the area of environmental plane or environmental interest. And that the contractor should be responsible for. I don't believe that such a large area, and this is of course that it's a different group, and should come and contribute, share, and this is one point. But anyway, I believe there's some work or some, responsibility or some even, should do something for the contract. And there's some link between the so-called preserved reference zone and the area of environmental interest. Certainly there's some links. So we are very clear about, because this answer, we could not, it's a very satisfied answer. If the future, their mining activity influence the areas, what happened, to stop or how to protect both the interest of the relevant the site. Then I believe that I think in this moment these areas, I mean the areas of environmental interest, should be based on, if we discussion the details, I mean the location, the numbers, when to establish, and by what standardization. I think we should best base it on the available best environment, data and information. And these days, from the different contractor, I think this is the data and even in working in this contract area. But it's very useful, I think, to improve the ideas. So why I think that learn from the experience of the model of CCC for the geological models, I think this is a very successful program. Why the authority not organize some such a similar program to analyze now the available data and more carefully and more scientifically? Then we make some judgment, the location, the size, the numbers, and then I think this is a scientific step. We should do that step by step. I believe this is very important. Then the coordination among the different group, I think this is my commentary point at this point. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Okay, it's 11 o'clock now. We'll take a half-hour coffee break and come back and see if we can figure out some section headings. Thanks very much. Let us get back to it. Dave has been kind enough to type some words up for us, and we'll do a live conversation and edit on this to see if we can try and bring some clarity to the conversation and move forward. So, Dave?
Thanks, Jim. Yeah, it's all gone horribly wrong. I'm back up here. I'm slightly embarrassed because this is really a very simplistic document, and in a sense, it tries to set out what I tried to explain in my first intervention, in that I think what the LTC needs is a relatively straightforward, short document against which we could annex a lot of the detailed information that we have. And this, as it suggests here, is a really just a framework proposal as to how that might be achieved. I go back to my point again, said it a couple of times, that I think any environmental management plan or any document like this, we could call it a strategy, we could call it whatever, has to be time limited. So the idea is that you have a document like this, and then you reappraise it and you reinvent another one. And in a sense, it's not intended to be legally binding. I don't know how that would work in the ISA, but certainly we would see that in my organization as an other agreement to which all parties were expected to buy into. In any introduction, I think it would be important in this document, and we can obviously add to this is only intended to be a guide, but to have various things that have been mentioned and various things that we already have. So we already know the legal mandate that the authority has for establishing environmental management as part of its operation, and we've already learnt about the guiding principles that are relevant to the authority and to this particular activity when it comes to environmental responsibilities. I think it would be important to define the CCZ, and we have that information, and we also have the Secretariat has easily the other relevant terms that could be added to this document. So that's great, because there's no work to do yet. Also, as Michael said in this morning's session, I think it would be important to have a description of the mining operation, the vulnerability of the environment to mining, and the potential impacts. And that's set out in section 4 of the document that we were given at the start of the workshop. And my view was that type of information could be summarized in a paragraph in an environmental management plan like this, and then it could be annexed in full as was seen to be fit. Quite important then would be, and we in my organisation spent ages arguing over a vision of what the environmental management plan or the strategy or the document, high level document like this should achieve. And I've tried to come up with some words here as to how the International Seabed Authority should see this. And my interpretation is that you know, we're talking about sustainable exploitation, we're talking about preserving representative and unique marine habitats and species as part of that. So it's exploitation and conservation married together. And I think it's quite nice, sometimes these vision statements are very short and clipped like that. It's quite nice to explain it underneath in just a little bit more detail. We can argue about that, we could probably argue about it for the rest of the year, but those high-level statements are quite important. And then as Craig was indicating earlier, I think this document needs to have some goals, and I've tried to call her Craig earlier, but I've tried to spell out what those goals might be as part of this document. And again, that's something I think probably that the legal and drafting experts here could look at. In the framework I'm suggesting, there would then be strategic aims, and I've started to spell out these strategic aims from the conversation this morning. So these are just ideas, but I think that those involved on the contractor side might want to build on these and develop them. In a sense, the idea would be that clearly contractors are working to their best intents to employ best environmental practices, and I think that would be the aspiration of the plan. But we've talked a lot about that second bullet point, harmonising the environmental data that's already been gathered. So as a strategic aim, I think that would be a strong aim, and it could be supported by the expertise we have here and that we learnt about on Wednesday morning. It was quite clear as an observer that we weren't entirely sure about the size of impact reference zones and preservation reference zones, and some guidelines are needed in this plan to look at how those might be developed. And then this is the point that Sam made, that there perhaps ought to be a look in this plan as well at some sort of rehabilitation strategy. So I think that can be a contained area which could be developed, and those look simple, and it's not supposed to be inclusive, but a group could look at whether those are appropriate, whether they could be added to, whether they are hitting the proper strategic aims that we want for an environmental management plan. And then I think as a separate exercise, there's a look at the environmental interest areas, and I've been was advised during the margins of the meeting that really we're really looking at a strategic environmental assessment of the 9-area proposal. So that is a very valid strategic objective of an environmental management plan. Are these areas the right areas? Are they in the right place? Do they stack together? Are there enough of them? Are there too many of them, and so forth? I think the idea would then be, on that basis, to certainly in my organisation, we would build up that information into a nomination pro forma for an appropriate area. We develop conservation objectives, and we develop management measures on that basis. And those management measures would really relate to a baseline evaluation of what was there in terms of biodiversity. And I hope that Pedro's presentation in a moment would complement that type of a game plan. And I still think that there's work to do in the areas in between. And this is my kind of simplistic look, and Dave Billett mentioned it earlier, that they're you know, the buffer area design between the contractor areas and the areas of environmental interest is an important element of this whole CCZ area. I don't think this is correct, what I've put here, but the idea is that there should also be some thinking going into the bits in between, not just the two sets of areas, and that they should in some way be integrated. The way I'd see an environmental management plan then would be to take these high-level strategic objectives and then to operationalize them. So for example, if we were looking to the contractors to apply best environmental practices and best environmental techniques, one way of achieving that, and one way that's been suggested in the documentation so far, is that the contractors could apply an environmental management system to do that. Or they could start to see how such a system might be applied. A softer way perhaps is that contractors would be sharing information of a non-confidential nature, and that would help to establish what the environmental impact the environmental impacts of mining techniques were. So this is a kind of nested approach. These operational objectives make the strategic objectives work, and then within that you need to develop management actions in an environmental management plan. So just taking that one that I've suggested, the environmental management system, the ISO 14001, one way of actioning that environmental management system would be that the contractors would work towards accreditation for ISO 14001. Now if that wasn't appropriate or the contractors didn't like that, you can soften that language, that they would take due account of ISO 14001, which is obviously a lot more palatable in money terms than reaching accreditation, which may delay your operation. So there are ways of wording this, there are ways that secretariats use to achieve these targets that I hope would then be acceptable to all. And then having gone through that process, so you've got your strategic level, your operational level, and your action level, then it's important to look at how that will be implemented. So how do you implement those sets of objectives, and then when do you review it? And that's the simple model that I'm most familiar with, and I think, as I was suggesting in my earlier intervention, we could adopt or we could make progress with here in our applying our various expertise. So that was what I was asked to set out, and I hope it's reinforcing what I said in my earlier intervention. Thanks.
I'll open the floor for comments. Malcolm?
Thanks, David. From a simple scientific perspective, I don't have really any issue with what you've presented. I think it's a packaging exercise. Having strategic objectives in there is great, because people are always going to want to know how does whatever we're talking about fit into the big picture. So my response really is to say, yep, that looks fine to me. It's whether it's fundamentally no different from the EMP structure in terms of its content than the one that Charles put together. It's given it maybe a higher level introduction, which I think, yep, you're right, it needed, but that I think works in well with hopefully what the ISA would require as well. So just from my perspective, you know, I'm happy to work within any sort of structure as long as the content is adequate, and that looks fine to me.
Charles?
Yeah, I would just like to echo that comment.
You're on.
Yeah, I think it's real clear that this is a better way to package it, and I think it provides the high level that we need to go to the council. So thank you very much, David. I think it's a good way to go. And I would just recommend that we break it up into two or three pieces and get started. So thank you very much.
Yes.
Thank you. I think it provides a very useful framework for proceeding. I just wanted to clarify that when I was speaking about a strategic environmental assessment, I was thinking about for the whole region as part of the overall environmental management plan as the glue that held it all together. That's, and I'm not sure of the timing of it, but it would seem if the contractors are interested on the impacts within the specific areas, somebody or something, ideally the authority, would be looking at the overall cumulative impacts of individual mining sites or potential impacts, as well as what would happen both within and without those areas, the whole region.
Thanks. Maybe if I could just comment on that. My understanding is because the contractor areas are already there, that any strategic environmental assessment wouldn't be revisiting the contractor areas, it would be revisiting how would you ensure that the areas around about them that might not be affected can be introduced. And I think that, you know, we have a strong proposal on the table for the nine areas. Does it need a further refining? And you could call that whatever you like, but normally that would be seen as a strategic look at in the light of the conversation we had this morning, that would be a strategic review of that nine area proposal. So I can see where you're coming from, but in effect, any strategic review isn't going to affect where the mining areas are, but it may affect where the areas of environmental interest are, or whether they you know, are sufficient.
It's just not clear if that's already been taken into consideration.
And I don't know either. But my understanding is from the discussion we've had in this workshop that it would be helpful to review that.
Then it might. I think we're just thinking of two different beasts, because from what I've seen, strategic environmental assessments are an overview of an activity and its impact on the marine environment and activity in general versus very site-specific activities. And I would assume maybe that's already been done, but you would want to have some better idea about the cumulative environmental impacts of mining within the Clipperton Fracture Zone. And it's not really part of the decision on these nine areas. I mean, that's just sort of a mitigating device. That's, maybe Dave have something to add.
Thank you. Yes, I, in terms of a strategic environmental assessment, as the only other sort of experience I've had is, say, in the oil and gas sector, where there are quite sort of strict regulations on each of the contractors or oil and gas companies in their specific areas. But what has been learnt from oil and gas activities is that there can be longer term and additive sort of effects on the environment, and therefore you take a strategic look at the whole area to make sure that you address those, A, the cumulative impacts, but secondly, multiple impacts that are of from different areas. So that is what is happening here. And in terms of the nine area plan, that was more or less what it was looking at: how can you preserve the biodiversity across the region in the light of these multiple impacts, if you like, and also cumulative impacts.
Yeah, I think that's correct. And the differentiation is between the strategic environmental assessment, which would look at the network of areas of environmental interest, and the environmental impact assessments that will be appropriate to individual mining operations, as I understand the theory. Is that correct, David?
Sorry, I was...
There's a differentiation between the strategic environmental assessment, which would look at the plan for the nine areas, and the environmental impact assessment that might be applied within a mining concession.
Absolutely.
Hello, I'm sorry, because I'm somewhat lost about what the document are. So can the secretariat provide us this document in paper? Because it's too small for me to catch. And also the language. Okay, thank you.
view. I'm still locked in word. I'm sure the secretary will circulate this, yeah?
David, I have a question about this. Now, based on what the other David said and Christina said, it seems to me that the strategic environmental assessment is actually one step above. That's looking at across the whole region and multiple impacts and multiple usages, whereas the environmental interest is a review or further consideration of the proposal, so that the strategic assessment, I think, is one step above. Is that correct? Want to cut that out and paste it some.
Yes, I agree with you, and I think that with the best will in the world, I don't want to keep standing up here and refining this document. Yeah? I think the idea is that the experts that have the key knowledge in those areas would develop this and refine the text and fill in the blanks. So, yeah.
Jen first, and then Sam.
Thank you very much for Professor Johnson, and I appreciate that the framework for this plan. But I also have a difficulty for the wording, and it's very difficult for us to just. You said correctly in this, we need time to study very carefully for your proposal, and especially, I just wonder that it's not clear for me that you mentioned the proposal for. It seems for the nine areas, or you still mention that? Having said that, I think we need time to read, especially for some substantial items. I just want to mention that some things. That this workshop, one of the topics is that the collaborative efforts by the each contract. And during my presentation, I introduced the collaborative efforts by Commerce. And actually, we coordinate the many scientists in a different field in China, from university, institute, or some companies, to do the work for the environment assessment, to collect the data and to analyze and standardize and try our best. Then I think if we touch the detail of these areas, I explained several times. I think it's very, we are very careful. We need more time for scientific analysis based on available data and information, especially from this day, from the different contractors. This is very important. Also, I think the secretary of the authority should play a very important role to coordinate. This is the next step. At this moment, we could not touch the details, as I said, the numbers, the size, the location, and we have no idea. And the scientists from our side, and I think maybe some, one idea I should clarify. That contractor is not only contractor. Contractor organize the scientists from different areas. They are also scientists. So this is very important. We hope different group from different field can together and very carefully study, analyze, standardize. This is the most important work we should do. Thank you very much.
Yes, thanks, Mr. Jin. I accept that. I think it's a collaborative effort, and that's, in a sense, a very important part of the balance that this plan should develop. And I see that as being particularly important in terms of this need to harmonise the and standardise the biodiversity information that's been done.
Sam?
So, Jim, I just wanted to check. Did you want to go through and sort of flesh out some of the other headings that might be?
Most certainly.
Okay, so I had just going through this, and some of them might be covered already, Dave, but maybe we can just go through them. And I was just looking at the headings.